go ahead and, oh, are we ready? Yes, one, two, four. Help I put it back on. There. That works better. Okay. Good morning. Thank you for being here together again as we meet as Peace Lutheran Church family to be able to worship our Lord again. We have a new day, a new week before us, and that again is a gift from the Lord that we acknowledge together with our responsory from Psalm 118 there. This is the day the Lord has made. So let us rejoice and be glad in it. Just a couple of quick notes before we get started here. Reminder, we have the baby bottle boomerang collection going for the New Beginnings Pregnancy Help Center. We kind of, with missing some of the services and then last week's special events and all, we may kind of glossed over that. But we want to remember that we have that to every year in this time period for collecting to help the work to protect the little ones and their families. So if you haven't yet, you plan to, would grab those bottles and take them with you. If you already got yours, keep accumulating with it, and we'll probably push it back by a week to be the second Sunday in March that we'll like to have them back by. So encourage you to participate with that. And just a reminder, 10 days from now is Ash Wednesday. It's already upon us. So there's stuff in your bulletin. It'll be in the newsletter this week coming out a little bit more about what we'll be doing together. But encourage you to already be thinking now about, okay, that's coming up. I want to be able to participate in that. 6 o'clock is when the service is each week for Lent on the Wednesday. So if you can come, be great. Chance to invite somebody with you that's not going to church right now to come and tap the toes in the water and just kind of see what it is that we do here together and get to meet some of your church family. So that's a couple of big things that we wanted to draw attention to together before we start. So let's go ahead, shall we, and begin worshiping our Lord together again as we have the privilege to do. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, my darling's coming on up, and we're going to share together here, starting off with the song Only Jesus, asking God to help us to stay focused on Him and His priorities for our lives.
Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers. But all an empty world can sell is empty dreams. I got lost in the light when it was up to me. To make a name the world remembers. But Jesus is the only name to remember. And I only got one life.
to remember.
I don't want to leave a legacy. I don't care if they remember me. Only Jesus.
Leave a legacy. I don't care if they remember me. Only Jesus.
That's our prayer, isn't it? That God would be glorified in our lives. Let's stand then, and we'll join in the second song, worshiping our Lord together to start things off today. We're going to do a song called Well Done, remembrance to us that our life and our times here matters. Sometimes people look at life and they say, what difference does it make? Just live party hardy till you die. Yeah, who cares? Nothing matters anyway. God says, oh, yeah, it does. He says he's already numbered each one of our days and before even one of them comes to be. It's that important. So we say, Lord, I want my life to be in your hands while I'm here. When I'm done on this world, I want to hear the words of Jesus. He says, well done, good and faithful servant. We want to be able to be those who are thankful for the time God gives us in this world to make a difference. And that's in our times we live in. A lot of people have forgotten that. So we rejoice that the Lord says, your life, your time on earth matters. May it be for his purposes is our prayer together again today. So let's sing, Well Done.
When my pain is gone and all the worries of this world just fade away, what will it be like when you call my name and that moment when I see you face to face? I'm waiting my whole life to hear you say, well done, well done, my good and faithful one. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done, well done, my beloved child. You have run the race and now you're home. Welcome to place where you belong. What will it be like when tears are washed away and every broken thing will finally be made whole? What will it be like when I come into your glory, standing in the presence of a love so beautiful? Waiting my whole life for that day. I will live my life to hear you say, well done, my good and faithful one. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done. You have run the race and now you're home. Welcome to the place where you belong. What would it be like when I hear that sound? All of heaven's angels crying out, singing, holy, holy,
until then I live to hear you say, well done, well done, a good and faithful one. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done, my beloved child. You have run the race and now you're home. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done.
It'll be a great day, isn't it? Now, is God going to say, well done, you were perfect? You didn't make any mistakes in life. Come on in, my child. If that's the case, we're all right. We acknowledge again the well done welcome, my child, is not because we were such good people. In fact, it's despite the fact that we are all sinful and unclean, because of Jesus forgiving our sins, that God wipes away the record of our sins with Christ's blood on our behalf. And then that's left on their accounts is the things that we have done that are good and faithful to the Lord. So we would have no chance of being welcomed into heaven were it not for the forgiveness of Jesus that covered over that record of our sins. So let's again together ask for his forgiveness in that trust and confidence that he grants it for those who believe in him. So let's ask that with a drawing back closer to God prayer. Heavenly Father, I confess that I have sinned against you and against people whom you love, both in what I've thought, said, and done, and in what I've failed to think and say and do. I need your mercy and help, Lord. Being honest before you and myself, I sincerely ask for your forgiveness, especially for the following. Let's continue then together. Forgive us, dear Father, for Jesus' sake, for revealing him as our true Savior. We trust in him alone for forgiveness and mercy. Help us, Holy Spirit, to delight ourselves in the Lord, striving to have thankful, joyful hearts, growing in faith, and expressing these virtues you bestow on us with love. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. We remember that Jesus said, John 10, he said that the thief, Satan, comes to steal and kill and destroy. He's not interested in our well-being. But Jesus says, I have come that you may have life and have it to the full. So we thank God that he has forgiven our sins as we've asked him in his great love for us and mercy. But he goes beyond that. Besides forgiveness and the gift of eternal life, he also says, I will be with you every day where you're here. I will help your life to grow and blossom in what it means to be God's people, different from the sinful world around you in a good way. So we have good reason to say, wow, thank you, Lord, for your mercy and forgiveness and for the good plans you have still for my life in your hands. So have a seat if we will, and let's take a look then at further what our God says to us in his word and applying it to our lives. Today, for the first reading, we're going to look at Isaiah chapter 6 for a minute here. Isaiah 6, verses 1 to 8. This is where sometimes it's called Isaiah's commissioning, where God sends him as a prophet. Before he ever goes as a prophet, he's not saying, God, you need to send me because I'm better than everybody else. He says, whoa, he says, I'm in the presence of Almighty God, and I am a sinner, and the people I'm around are sinners. I am toast. And God says, you don't need to be toast because I choose to forgive you. And as he forgives Isaiah for his sin, then he says, now who will go and serve? And Isaiah says, I'm ready. Send me. You know, we're in that same boat. None of us has any business saying, I'm the Lord's and I'm going to go out and tell people about Jesus because we're just so much better than everybody else. No. It's because we've been forgiven for our sin first. And God's the one that calls us and says, would you now serve me? That we can then say, I'm ready, Lord. Thank you for all you've done for me. I want others to know about it too. So we can relate to this, even though it happened a long time ago, 700 some years before Jesus walked on the earth, still very pertinent to our times today. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphs, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and the threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined. I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth, and he said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." And then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? Who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I. Send me." And that's how far we'll get in the first of our readings from God's Word. All right, we're going to go ahead, my darling, come back up, and we're going to sing together the song Evidence, being able to say we've got good news to share with the world around us about the Lord, not only from what the Bible says, but also just seeing how God provides so much bounty and blessing in our world, in our own lives, takes care of us day to day. Good reason to trust him, to thank him, and to tell others about him too. So let's sing Evidence.
All throughout my history, your faithfulness has walked beside me. The winter storms make way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life. Help me remember when I'm weak. Fear may come, but fear will leave. You lead my heart to victory. You are my strength, and in you always will be. I see evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. See the cross, the empty grave, the evidence is endless. All my sin go away because of you, oh Jesus. I see the cross, the empty grave. The evidence is endless. All my sin go away because of you, oh Jesus. Oh, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life.
Take a look at some more of the Lord's Word together today. We're going to continue the series we've been doing here for a few weeks called The Word of God during Epiphany. Epiphany is, of course, a time we remember that Jesus came into the world and revealed himself, made known, the word Epiphany is, made known that he is the promised Savior that was to come and to teach as well as show by his miracles that he is God in the flesh who had come. So we're going to be looking today at the next of our part of the series on the Word of God, at the transforming nature of God's Word. For that, we're looking at Luke chapter 5, beginning with the first verse, Luke 5. That's on page 1597 in the Pew Bibles, or if you got your own Bible, I always encourage you to grab that and look that up, mark it up together. It's your tool book. You'll be able to make use of it. It shouldn't be just like a set of tools that's all brand new, never got any grease or any scratches or anything on it because it's just sitting on a shelf. What good is your toolkit if you never use it? That's the same thing with the Bible. You're going to get it marked up. You're going to get it pages crinkled. Maybe you get coffee stains once in a while on it. But that's all right because that means you're using it. It's a tool God has given us for our souls to be encouraged and grow in faith in the Lord and understand him better. So let's take Luke chapter 5. I'm going to start together with verse 1. Jesus here is dealing with the whole concept of whether change can happen. You ever had that conversation with people? Can change, somebody be transformed? Or are people pretty much going to stay the way they are? It's an interesting debate, isn't it? If you're talking with somebody and they're saying, maybe it's a friend you've got, and they're saying, I've been dating this guy, and he's really got a lot of prospects for good things. He's kind of got some problems, and then it tells you the problems, you know. You say, but he tells me that he's going to do better. He's going to change, and he's going to not do that kind of thing anymore. What would your advice be to that friend? Depends, doesn't it? You may say, well, I'm sure that person's going to do really well in being a new person and turn it over a new leaf, and you can just trust him and go ahead and marry him if you want to right away, and it'll all be wonderful, I'm sure. Or not. You may not tell them that. You may say, sometimes people are going to be the way they are rather than what they say they want to be. Does your experience bear that out in life? Do you find that you kind of see how somebody's living and that's more what you expect than if they tell you they're going to be different now and better than they were before? I find it interesting. They say that a lot more people now doing interviews on job applications and such are saying they're not emphasizing as much as they used to. Used to say, okay, here's the company, here's the needs we have. How will you be able to fit into and fulfill this need? And the recipients of this interview process saying, oh, I will do this, 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 and this. All these grandiose plans, and I'll just be the perfect fit for what you need. All sounds good, doesn't it? But in reality, it doesn't always turn out the way you'd hope. So what they've been doing, they say more now, is not taking a lot of time to hear all of your plans of what you're going to do if you get hired. They want to know, what are you doing now? What have you done 5, 10 years ago? They want to know your current practices. And the people that study all this stuff said that's going to tell you a lot more about how that person is going to do at this job you're applied to than their dreams and hopes and goals that they're going to grow into and become and develop. Interesting, isn't it? It's true of a lot of things when you think about that. Talked with somebody a while back that was saying that's true when it comes to people that are dating somebody after they've been met them, and they say, well, they're just so nice, they're just so kind and so respectful, and they just really take care of time to focus on me. And you're like, okay, well, how long have you been dating? We've been together 3 weeks now, you know. And the person said, well, I got some advice for you. I would encourage you to wait 3 months, see how things are going with this person, but keep your guard up a little bit there for 3 months. He said, most people, if they're putting best foot forward, which we all try to do when we're first dating somebody, most people that put the best foot forward will try really hard to really behave well and be impressive and all. They say people can hold that up for a while, but most average people, after about 3 months, they start to get comfortable and relax. And when you get comfortable and relax, you start to be who? Not your ideal person, but you start to be yourself. Now, would you rather get to see somebody in their ideal, foot-forward, shiny person? Or would you rather see them for who they really are? That's the goal, isn't it? Is that you want to see what this person is really like if you're going to invest possibly building a relationship long-term with them, get married to them someday. You don't want to marry somebody that just gives you all these promises. You want somebody who actually, what their lifestyle is something that you say, this is what I would like to be around with this person for my life together. Even God, did you know this? Even God in Jeremiah 13 says, can a leopard change its spots? You ever tried to get the spots off of a leopard before? I haven't. I have no experience with that, but I'm going to take it for granted pretty much that what God is saying there is, no, you don't take the spots off of a leopard. The leopard's got the spots that he was born with. And that's interesting because God himself in that context was saying, my people are prone to being evil. They're not just going to suddenly turn around and start being all holy and following me and doing things right. He said they're going to have my intervention in their hearts and lives. And that's the point we want to take with us thinking about today. When God talks about transforming people through his word, he's saying it's going to have to be something that's going to happen because of him, not because of us. So let's take a look at this. This is a big difference. Sometimes we think, well, I'll get my life all straightened out and be a good person, and then I'll get together with God, and then we'll click well. How long is that going to work, right? You know, it's not going to be something that God says you're going to be mine when you get your act together and you do everything right. Then we'll talk. He says, I know that you're like the leopard with the spots. You are a sinful being, and you are never going to please me with what you can do on your own. That's why Jesus came into the world. So let's take a look at this as Jesus spreads this hope of the transforming power of God's word in lives of people by his power, not by ours. Luke 5, first starting with verse 1. It says, one day as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret with the people crowding around him and listening to the word of God, he saw at the water's edge two boats left there by fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon Peter, and he asked him to put out a little from the shore. And then he sat down and he taught the people from the boat. Jesus was in the world as the promised Savior. He could have just said, all right, where's the cross? Let's get this done. And just got taken care of, you know, and been back to heaven with his dad by the weekend, right? You know, he spent 3 years in intense public ministry in the flesh here walking the earth. And a lot of that time was spent showing his power as God so that people knew this is God's word when he speaks. But he also took a lot of time to do this, to teach, to speak, and be the word of God. And we're so thankful we have recorded and we're able to hear as well, to be the one who's investing time and effort into people hearing what God has to say. He is one that knows God is able through his word to transform and change people's lives. Why would he waste any time here if he knew that we were all hopeless? It's awesome, isn't it, that God says, you can't change yourself, but I can bring that. Philippians 2, he talks about that. He says, it is the power of God by which you have the will and the deeds for following his purposes. It's only because of God's work that any of us believes in the Lord. Only because of God's power that we learn how to work and think and be more like Christ and less like the sinful world around us. So Jesus takes time to say, I'm sharing my word with you. I know that God will be able to change your heart for good if you just let him have it, access to your heart. So here he is talking to people from the boat, and they're listening. Then it says, verse 4, when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep water and let down the nets for a catch. Simon answered, Master, we have worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down the nets. What do you think? Was Peter really thinking, yeah, this is going to be great? You know, he's an experienced fisherman. He'd been out the best time when he was supposed to catch fish was at nighttime there. Got zip not of nothing. Tired, grumpy, I'm sure. Comes in and says, I just want to go and get something to eat and go sleep. And here Jesus is saying, oh, while you're here, Peter, let's go ahead and have you go out and let's have you go and put your net in again. So he's like saying, okay, Master. I pretty much know. I mean, I'm no dummy. I wasn't born yesterday. I know this is going to be a waste of time. But because you asked me, all right, I'll do it just this once. You know, you can almost hear that in his voice, right? Interesting. He's giving what sometimes they call tentative trust to the Lord. He says, I'll give a little bit that is against what I think, because I'm going to trust you, but I'm going to watch. And we'll see. If I trust you this way and it's a bust, you can guarantee I'm not listening to you again. Zero to that. But we'll see. It's kind of interesting because that's the way it is for a lot of people when it comes to God today as well. A lot of people, by our sinful nature, we are resistant to God. We are quick to judge and condemn the things that he says and wants, because we feel in our sinful nature, we kind of feel like we got life all figured out. You kind of get to that point where you say, well, I've not been around, you know, just since yesterday. I know how the world works. I live my life. I'm used to how things are for me. So anybody tries to tell me different from what I see and know, what do they know? Even God, if we're honest. Sometimes we tell God, God, now, come on. You know, you're in heaven. You're not living in my shoes. I know what my life is like. I know what works for my people that are around me. And we may say, all right, you're God, so I'll give you a little chance. Now, you think about that. That of itself is a great gift, just like what happened with Peter. Peter wasn't at a place he had to say, I'll do whatever you say, Lord, because I know that you're God Almighty and I am your servant. He didn't say any of that yet. He wasn't ready for that. But he gave this little bitty opening. That hard heart sealed away and says, I don't want God messing with my life. Had a little bitty pinhole. And the Holy Spirit was going to be able to come and intervene into his heart and his life. This is where we pray that. For our own selves, more and more as time goes on, that God will help us have tentative trust. We may say, I don't want to do it. God tells me, I know he tells me, pie in the sky, this is going to be so good, so much better, helpful to everybody. But I just want to do life my way. To say once in a while, Lord, all right, Master, I know this isn't going to work, but since you're asking me to do this in your word, I'll give it a try. Just kind of look back at your life and see maybe some places you've had that happen where you weren't so sure you want to be doing something, but you gave it a little bit of a try. And the Lord got a hold of you and grabbed and taught and built and has used you in ways you never would have thought would have happened. That's how God's able to get in to do that, not just for you and for me, but for others around us too. We may see a lot of people and think, they just don't want to hear what the Bible says. They don't want to go to church. They don't want to let the Lord speak to their heart and their life. But as we share with Christ's words to them, they may have that little bitty crack in their heart that God has worked. And it'd be something through which the Holy Spirit will begin to start to work and build truth and trust in their hearts. And they may very well then get to the point where they believe in the Lord fully and are headed to heaven as well. So it's interesting. It starts pretty small sometimes, but God perseveres. So we see here, he gives this little bitty tentative trust, saying, all right, we'll throw it on the nets at least this once for you. So verse 6 says, when he had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and to help them. And they came and they filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, oh, Jesus, you are God. I can tell now. Oh, Jesus, whatever you want me to do, I'll be glad to. I'm going to be right there by your side for the rest of eternity. I renounce all my evil ways I used to do and my cursing I used to do with my buddies and carousing and any kind of behavior. Wait a minute. Did you read that here? You know, that would have been ideal, wouldn't it? You know, he just immediately, I believe in the Lord. I've seen him before me, the miracle he's just done for me. I'm in, 100%, 120%. You don't see that, do you, when you see here? Look at what Peter says. He just sees this magnificent miracle of all these fish. There's absolutely no way this would happen in any normal circumstances. And it did. Right in front of his face, he's participating. And what does he say? He says, go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man. He is looking at his life now, not at what Jesus has got in mind for him in the future. He says, well, this is how I am. Never come across somebody like that in your life? You're talking about the Lord, talking about faith, talking about spiritual things. They're just like, no, that's not me. That's this other person. That's my mama. A lot of them will say that. My mama was a very deep religious person, but not me. That's just not for me. I'm too sinful. I like my sin. I like my sinful friends that don't care about God. I like my lifestyle. I'm a creature of habit. I'm stuck, and I'm going to just stay there. Now, is that true? Well, yes and no, isn't it? If a person doggedly says, I am not going to listen to God, I am not going to try the things he says, I'm not going to let his word into my heart, yeah, a person can choose to be stuck in sin and pushing God away. God's not going to force anybody to follow him. But Peter made a bad assumption here, saying, Lord, I can't be around you because I'm a sinful person. I do things wrong. I don't understand a lot of spiritual stuff. I don't know what to do with it. God didn't say, now, Peter, you can only be with me if you're a really good person already and you've renounced every evil thing you've ever done and said. He's interested in the sinful man that nonetheless Jesus died to pay for here pretty soon. He's interested in you and me and the rest of the people in our lives around us. He died for them also because they matter. He says, you matter to me too. This is what we want to remember, is that Peter made a big error of assumption when he said, I am sinful. It's just the way it is. So God, you got to go. And look at what Jesus responds to him. Second half of verse 10 there, it says, then Jesus said to Simon, don't be afraid. To me, this is something that's really helpful to remember. You know, he's looking at Peter. He knows him. He loves him. He knows his thoughts. He doesn't say, Peter, quit being a jerk. He doesn't say, Peter, quit thinking that you're all that tough guy. He says, Peter, don't be afraid. To me, that's very insightful, of course, that God understands. When someone says, I am sinful, therefore, God, you have to go. Jesus sees that this is really underneath that bravado, tough guy stuff is fear. Fear that I may not be able to measure up to being God's follower. I may fail him. I may grumble against him. I may not know what to do. I may compare myself now to other people that are Christians and feel like I'm so much less than they are. All that stuff stirring around, you can imagine, can't you? And then you plug it in for you and for me. Sometimes we do the same thing. Even though we are already Christians, we still may say, Lord, but I'm a sinful person. I can't do what you asked me to do. I can't take on this new challenge or this new responsibility for you. I can't be involved in that person's life. I don't know what to do to relate to them. They're different from me. And on and on and on and on we can go. And we end up, because we're scared of what might God expect, what might God have us have to learn, do different, how am I going to handle all this? We just want to push it away. And you got people in your life that's probably the same way. Maybe there's, I'll bet you most all of us have somebody you've shared the Lord with over years of time and prayed for them and want them with all your heart for them to know Jesus as their Savior and be headed to heaven too. And they're not ready yet. They're saying, I'm a sinful person. That religion stuff, that's for you. That's for other holy people. That's not for me. And we just, our hearts just ache for them because we know that they're scared. They're scared of what's going to happen to me if I say yes to Jesus Christ. This is where Jesus reminds them. He says, don't be afraid. But from now on, you will catch men. From now on. Man, that's such a little bitty phrase, and that is such a big phrase. What is he saying? He says, from now on. He's saying, you used to be this, and now you're going to be different. God is able and willing to transform Peter's life, thinking, habits, patterns, focus, priorities, joys. And this is what God promises he will do for him and for you and for me and for people out there as well. From now on, sometimes people think, I've been too bad of a person. I can never be forgiven by God. I can never be a Christian. I can never be able to talk to somebody else about the Lord because they know my background and yada, 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 yada. God says, nope. He says, that's not the way it is. A simple world may say you're hopeless. He says, I will never say you are hopeless. You are able to be transformed by the power of my Holy Spirit working through my word. He says, trust me and try, just as he said here for Peter. And it's pretty amazing to think about that. You know, from this point, you will catch men. You are not locked into being what you were before. You're not stuck. He says, you are able to be changed. And that's something that we can rejoice in each of our lives. Maybe you can remember back years ago what life was like and what it's like now. And you may have a testimony and say, yeah, God really has changed my heart, my life, my way of thinking and doing things. Praise be to him. And that's an important encouragement to give to other people too that aren't quite there yet, to be able to remind them, yeah, the Lord, he did it in my life. He can do it in yours too. That's a great gift God gives. Jesus is the one that says, after all, he says to people, don't be afraid of me. He says, remember, in Matthew 11, he says, all of you that are weary, weak, heavy laden, struggling, come to me. He says, come and take my yoke on you, because my burden is light and my yoke is easy, and you will find rest for your soul. And this is the imagery Jesus used, and we can't hardly relate to this in our times. How many oxen and yoke have you worked with late in the last 10 years? Not too many for me. But see, back in these days, the oxen being tied to the yoke, they were pictured often of they would go around those grist mills, round and round and round all day long, grinding grain for their masters. The big, solid, trained, sturdy oak or oxen, they were used to it. They got food. They got to sleep at night. They were happy. So they took care and did their work, and they got done, did the next day again and again and again. The little bitty oxens that were coming up, though, they were wanting to, what? What do kids usually want to do? I want to play. I want to have fun. They didn't want to do the work that was expected to do. Now, what would it have been like if they had taken that little bitty oxen, put the big, heavy grist mill grind yoke on its back, and then just beat it until it walked around in circles all day for months? Would that be a good way to train it? I don't know. I've never tried training oxen, but I like what they did back in these days instead of that. They took the big oxen that did all the work, and they put the yoke together with the little bitty ones. So the little bitty one was tied with a separate special yoke to the big one that carried the yoke of the grist mill. And the big one did his thing, walked around calmly and took care of business, did all the hard work all day long. The little guy was just, pull, I don't want to do this. And eventually he learned, instead of fighting all the time and trying to get away from everything I'm responsible for, I'm actually learning to be a part of this team. And by the time they did it long enough, the young oxen had learned how to be able to grind as well and did a good job. And one day he would teach the young ones to do it too. And Jesus uses that image to say, this is what life with him is like. He's not saying, become a Christian so you will have to do all the hard work that I don't want to do. You know, the first thing you're going to do is have to clean out the stall and the horse pens of heaven. No, you know, he's not there saying, I'm going to take advantage of you. I'm going to find ways to get everything from you and take everything away from you like sometimes people think. He says, I am the one that's doing the work. I'm the one that paid for all of your sins on the cross. I'm the one that's running this whole world and keeping things going. I want you to attach to me. Let me take your worries away. Let me help you with your life. Let me show you how life works better when you follow my lead and example. That's what Jesus is saying to him, to you, and to me. Don't be afraid. Trust me. Let's go. Let me transform your life. It says they pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed him. All right. They said, okay, we're going to do this, Lord. After that, did they have everything go great from then the rest of their life? They were perfectly devoted to the Lord, always understood everything he said and taught, always put into place. I see somebody shaking their head saying, no, really? You mean they weren't the perfect people when they became Christians? Beeper over and over again. No. Are you and I? Because we're Christian, do we now have no more struggles, no more doubts, no more fears, no more uncertainties? No. That's part of life, a whole life of being a Christian, but also being a sinful being that struggles in this world. We don't understand what God's got going sometimes. We don't like it sometimes. God says, I know. He worked with these guys. These three, James and John and Peter, became his closest three inner circle of the 12 apostles. Some of the closest relationships that Jesus in the flesh had in this world. Amazing. They had no idea that God was going to do this. And yet his plans for them was fulfilled. And they learned and they grew. Same for you and for me. Same for somebody we're sharing Jesus with out there right now. They're like, I don't know. I just kind of want to tell God, leave me alone. I'm a sinful person that's going to stay stuck that way. Don't get them off that easy. Say, just try. Just see. Give it a little bit of a chance. And be patient and pray for them. It may take time. It may take a long time for somebody to finally be ready to take on the yoke of Jesus and let him teach them. And he's not going to force anybody. Not you, not me, not them. But we pray for, we encourage, we love them. We try to model for them the difference Jesus makes in our life. We can do that. And then ask God to continue to do his transforming work in their hearts and lives along with us. So these are things that we pray for. In these times we live in our lives, just as happened for back in Peter and his life. And we thank God that he is not done with us yet and will continue his transformative work by the power of his Spirit through his word. We ask for this to continue in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand. Let's come to our Lord in prayer together. Heavenly Father, we do thank you that you have loved us so much, that you have sent your Son, our Lord Jesus, to be our Savior, and the Holy Spirit, who's working through your word to transform our hearts in our lives. Thank you that you brought us to saving faith. Thank you that you continue to teach us and develop us, help us to feel the fear we may have of not letting you in too close to our circle of thinking and doing things and wanting to kind of hold on to our old ways. Help us to trust you, to put your ways into practice more and more as our life goes on. Thank you that we have each other in the church family to encourage each other on, to strengthen one another in that lifelong pursuit of growing in the word of the Lord. Help us to look around and see people in our lives day to day that at this point are struggling with their relationship with you. We think right now in our hearts of somebody that we know, we want them to have a trust and love with you and for you and understand your plans for them and have that saving faith in your forgiveness, Jesus. But right now we don't believe they're there yet. So we pray for them by name before your throne of grace right now. We pray, dear Lord, for your healing and your help for all who are facing hardships and struggles, all different forms that they take in this life. Specifically, a couple things we do pray, and thanks to you for Kathy Wheeler's husband, Everett, having come successfully through a heart procedure this past week. Continue to heal him, we pray. Thank you that you kept watch over Kathy Mahalski as she got her other cataract surgery done this past week. Continue to heal her, we pray. We pray for your continued deliverance from COVID and from all of its effects across the world. We pray for your help for our nation with all the struggles and strains that she's having. We pray for your help with the Russia and Ukraine clash that's going on right now, that you would help everybody involved and end up not having it be outbreak of war, but to be able to resolve things in a peaceful and truly good and wise way. And we pray these things then, all is in our hearts, Lord, in the name of Jesus, he who has taught us to pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please have a seat, if you will, at this time, if we can. Have those of you who are serving in this 2022 year as the various team function groups, the different offices of the church. This includes LWML and Ironworks as well. And you guys that are serving in different offices and positions, if you would please come up at this time. Every year we have the reinstallation together, and we're thankful. We can't do church without different ones helping out. So all of you who are in those positions, if you would please come up, and we'll get a chance to install you and pray for you again for 2022. All right, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, you have been selected to fill positions of responsibility in the various team ministries of our congregation. In the presence of God and of this congregation, I therefore ask you, do you accept the offices that have been entrusted to you? Do you promise faithfully to carry out your duties, trusting in the Lord and conforming yourself to his word in accordance with the faith of the Evangelical Lutheran Church? If so, then answer together, we do with the help of God. We do with the help of God. May then the Almighty and most merciful God, our Heavenly Father, enlighten and strengthen you in your positions of service, that you may be good and faithful stewards to the glory of his name and the good of his people. Amen. We pray. O Lord God, visit, we pray, this congregation and these servant leaders you have appointed with your love and favor. Enlighten their minds with the light of your gospel. Place in their hearts a love of the truth and increase in them true faith. Nourish them with your goodness and of your great mercy. Keep them in your love as we work together to renew hearts and redeem lives through Jesus. We ask these things in his precious name. Amen. We'll go then in the peace of the Lord. May the Almighty and most merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless and preserve you. Amen. On behalf of Peace Lutheran Church, all of the folks, Thank you very much. We appreciate you so much. God bless you as you continue to faithfully serve the Lord by serving his people. And I look forward to working together with you and being about our Father's business together again this year. So if you would go ahead and join with me and thank these folks for being willing to serve. We appreciate it. First service had several, of course, that are involved too. So we need people to be able to help with all those different positions. And we thank you guys for being willing to do so. All right, we'll go ahead then and we'll celebrate the Lord's Supper together then at this time, the gift that Jesus gives to us of his very body and blood in a supernatural way, that we may receive his assurance of his love and forgiveness for our sins, and a reminder that he binds us to himself and to each other. So we remember then that our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, and he said to them, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And the same way also, Jesus took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Okay, Mark, come up. We'll go ahead and we'll celebrate the Lord's Supper together.
When the best of me is barely breathing, when I'm not somebody I believe in, hold on to me. When I miss the light, the night is stolen, when I'm slamming all the doors you've opened, hold on to me. Hold on to me. Hold on to me when it's too dark to see you. When I am sure I have reached the end. Hold on to me when I forget I need you. When I
now they may boast this precious body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen and keep each of you strong in faith unto life everlasting. Depart in his peace. Amen. Shall we stand and finish off then with our summary of our faith together, stated by our creed there in the back? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, this is the week the Lord has made, so let us rejoice in it and make it count for him. Lord, then bless and keep each of you. Lord, make his face shine on you, be gracious to you. Lord, look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen. Thank you for being here. I hope you have a terrific rest of the day and week. See you then, hopefully, next Sunday.
Making diamonds out.